Europe, so therefore he rubbed elbows with royalty, and they were always very friendly, very nice, very down to earth. Mm-hmm. And Margarita and her husband told my father one day in April, or the end of March it was, in 1930, you have 2 weeks to get out, they're going to kill you, Dr. Krippos, and leave everything behind. Don't allow anyone to know what you're doing. Don't even say goodbye to your relatives, because that'll tip them off. So they came over on a ship called the Bremen, and they arrived. They were supposed to arrive in Nebraska. Mm-hmm. And as fate would have it, when they came here to America, to Ellis Island, the people that represented them in Nebraska said, we don't want the responsibility. And then they were told, you have a choice of New York or Baltimore. And my father chose Baltimore because they had what they called Deutsches Verein. They were a very elite group of businessmen, scientists, and so on. So that's how
Iran would be the German association,
but they were of course not anti-Nazi, and also, but they helped each other out.
Yeah, yeah.
So I mean, you could get rent for, this was during Depression, you could get rent for a dollar for a month, just as a token thing. Yeah, yeah.
What was the last name, the family name of your father?
Krippos. K. It was in German, it's spelled K-U with an umlaut, P-P-E-R-S, but we spelled it K-U-E-P-P-E-R-S.
New spelling, yeah.
Yeah.
What was the area that he specialized in? Was he an engineer? Was he a physicist?
He was an engineer. He was a physicist. He had about 6 doctorates, I found out later.
Do you remember the particular
areas that he was a specialist in? Just... If you do happen to remember them, it would be interesting.
He used to always say, I'm just a draftsman at Glenn L. Martin Company, but he was also a physicist. He was a nuclear physicist. I found out later that he designed the mathematical formula for bringing the astronauts back. He also designed the timing mechanism on the atom bomb. He also worked with the men to for the electrical system on the miniaturization of the equivalent to the American Sputnik. You know, the Russians, of course, had a larger one, but we had the one that was the size of the grapefruit. I remember he worked on that. He also worked in mind control. He worked in Project Blue Book, and he used to say, ah, it's not Blue Book. He says Black Book is the important one. And I found out many things that he did, including working with aliens and on the moon and in the moon.
During his time in Germany, do you remember, how old were you when you left Germany? Do you remember the particular areas? Was he working for a university? Was he working for a research facility? Or was he working for his own private business, electrifying the castles of European nobility?
He worked for himself, but somehow he knew Wernher von Braun over there. Mm-hmm. He knew who he was. He worked with V-2 rockets also. He worked with Glenn L. Martin Company over here in America, in Baltimore, as a matter of fact.
Do you remember what particular field was he working in at this company?
Oh, at Glenn L. Martin?
Yeah.
When he came to America, he worked as an electrical engineer. That's what he said to us. But then he would disappear, and I wouldn't see him for months and months. Sometimes he'd come home only twice a year.
When he was disappearing, was he just working day and night at his company nearby, or was he leaving the town and going elsewhere?
We always knew where he was. He was just out of town, and only my mother would know exactly where he was in case one of us got sick or something. One of the projects he worked on was in Montauk in Long Island, because he lived in Farmingdale, and he worked there for several years for RCA.
Mm-hmm. Has he discussed, I know it's very rare in people that work on such projects really discuss with their family what exactly they're involved in, But do you remember any clues from him that actually he was involved in very special, very advanced projects at the time?
Yes, I do, because he used to talk to me when I was maybe a very little child. He talked to me like I was 25 or 30 years old. And he would always say, pay attention, remember what I say, because later on in life you will need this information. So he says, just allow it to go into your mind and think about it. And then he says, when you're ready, he says, you'll probably be around. He always just said, he says, when you're around 55, it'll all come back to you.
Hmm. Very interesting. I'm just trying to figure out for myself whether he may have been involved in some super secret German projects behind the surface of his official work at the electrification company. Because some of the researchers in Germany that were working on these projects were moved to the United States even before the things got very serious in Germany due to the Nazis. Einstein was, well, he officially emigrated, but I have a feeling that some of these researchers have been moved to the United States with a tacit cooperation of the American and the German government. Do you have a feeling that this could have been the case?
Yeah. I do. The more and more I think about it, because I was born in 1935, and I was born in Baltimore. I'm American. I was born here. When he was working with the Glenn L. Martin Company, I remember it was such secrecy, always secrecy, and we were never allowed to speak on the phone, write letters, etc. But I remember a letter, very important letter, and my mother showed it to me. I was very, very small. It might have been, who knows, but at the beginning of the war, I'm not really sure time-wise. And she showed me the letter, and she held it over a big coffee can. And she says, do you see this letter? And I said, yes. She says, I want you to always remember it. It was handwritten by Goering. It was Goebbels. And he was, I believe, the foreign minister.
The minister of propaganda.
Right. But he wanted my father to work for him even then. And he wanted him to work on the V8, V2 engines and so forth. But my mother read this letter to me, and I was so impressed that this, he was very kind, and he asked my father to please join him, etc., etc. My mother said, Daddy told me that I should read this letter to you, and that I should say to you that this is a momentous occasion, and then she set a match to it. And it went into the coffee can.
You were in America.
Oh, yeah. I was in Baltimore. And she says, if we don't burn this, she says, with the kind of job that your father has, we'll all be killed.
Did the letter arrive through probably some secret channel to your father, not through the official post, I suppose?
All I know is the letter. That's all I remember. I don't remember if it was just mailed to the house or what. I have no idea. But then again, it had to be right before World War II. Otherwise, how else could the letter have gotten there?
Very interesting. Let me reiterate the last question, because what I kind of begin to suspect following the life, following the life stories of several famous German scientists, we all know about Operation Paperclip and several other secret operations that were going after the end of the Second World War, where Allies were scrambling for every German engineer, scientist, and technician they could lay their hands on. The headhunters were combing Germany, especially the underground establishments, and trying to figure out who worked where and to round and cart all these people to the United States. But this happened after the war. I have a feeling that the most important scientists were moved to the United States before even the war ended. Remembering the story of Wilhelm Reich, the inventor of the orgon energy and one of the first methods for mind control using particular sexual practices or his organ energy hardware. He was moved to the United States in 1942, several years before the war ended. Obviously, the elite here realized that he's too precious to risk him being killed in the last war days of, in the last 2 years of the war in Germany. We also know that the American elite has been secretly in collusion and cooperation with the Germans and even has been financing him. I mean, Wall Street was the chief financier behind the rise of Hitler to power in the Nazi Party, and major American industrial interests have been have had close cooperation with the German industry all throughout the war. So the higher we go up in this hierarchical level of conspiracies, the more we realize that basically the American secret government, the American ruling elite here, well, they were almost the best buddies with the German ruling elite. And many of these secret projects that are run in different feuding countries, in Russia, the United States and Germany, before or after the Second World War, the general public thinks that these are the most bitter possible enemies, but at these higher levels they become probably the best possible friends, or quite good, on quite good speaking terms. Because all these projects, in my opinion, are coordinated and orchestrated by management hierarchies that go beyond the terrestrial level, that go into the extraterrestrial and the celestial level. So they are very skillfully coordinated in all the major superpowers in the feuding country, despite the wars that go on, as a smokescreen, as a facade. So many of these scientists have been moved back and forth between these projects, and all these projects have been coordinated by this secret hierarchy. Do you remember any clues or any recollections that you may have that may lead to such a notion? I may be totally wrong. This is just a hunch of mine that I have.
You have excellent memory. In fact, it's almost indelible in my mind. My father and mother, especially my father, was extremely good friends with some very German, very elite German scientists who came to our house.
Can you name some?
Yes, I can. I even tell you who they look like, and I have some pictures in my baby album of some of them, like at my brother's baptism, which was in 1938. So Dr. Nagel was one, Dr. Peiter, P-E-I-T-E-R. Then he had a friend by the name of Wetbesch, W-E-D, B-E-R-G, in he was in Project Montauk. I know he worked in that there with him. I'm trying to think of who else. Let's see. I remember him talking about Tesla. I remember him talking about Einstein.
What did he talk particularly about Tesla and Einstein?
Oh, my father had some Tesla equipment, and so when I was small, he had a box about this big, and it looked like a radio. And he put me in a little chair, and he put a box here and a box there. And he put on very high frequency. And I was a very obedient child, but I was, even though at two, I was not a child, and I was never considered one at home. And being German parentage, very disciplined child, he would say, he put these sounds up higher and higher each time he'd come home, which was seldom. He says, "Now sit there." And he was very kind, but firm. He says, "Now, raise your finger when you don't hear the sound anymore. We'll see how you can hear the sound." And he explained to me how animals can hear very high frequency. And he says, "Maybe I can be able to train you to hear like a dog or an animal." And I would sit there very obediently, a small child, my little ringlets and my little starched dress, and I'd just sit there very obediently, and I went like this. And that's it. And then he'd give me a reward, you know, going on a streetcar ride or go to the museum or something. So that was a big deal. I loved that, you know. And then we'd have an ice cream and apple pie, and that was my great reward with my father, my pleasure to help him.
So he was training you with his Tesla equipment to hear some high audible frequencies. Do you remember him talking something, commenting something about Tesla, anything about projects that Tesla was working on?
He would, when I was around, let's say around 8, I remember looking, I don't know if this was Tesla, but I remember I looked at a reward that he had gotten from RCA Company as being a wonderful participant or engineer or whatever they called him. I don't quite remember, but I can tell you what it looked like. It was brown in background, and I still have it. I mean, I personally have this award that proves in 1943 what he did. And I said, Daddy, what did you get this reward for? And I said, why don't you hang it downstairs? He says, no, people shouldn't see that. And I said, well, what is this for? He says, it was an experiment in time. And I said, but what's that? He says, maybe you won't understand. And I said, try me. But remember, I had the conversation in German. So he got a cigar box, and he put some, he was sawing away, and he got some steel filings. And when he got the steel filings, he put them in the box, and he taped a big magnet, a big U-shaped magnet underneath, and he started tapping it. I saw concentric circles in this box. And I said, what is that? He says, it's, you know, the magnetism. He showed me on the two circles that were perfect. He says, you see that? He says, it's not what you see in life, it's what you don't see that's important. And I said, well, what about time? What does this have to do with it? And he thought that was a very good question, because you never questioned my father when he was in the middle of a conversation. He was one of those guys. And he took an ashtray here and another ashtray here. So he moved this ashtray to this side. And he said, he showed me how time could move from one spot to the other. And I remember certain things, because my mother's birthday was August 12th, and he always brought her a big bouquet of flowers. And I said, oh, Daddy, isn't it wonderful that you're honoring my mother on August 12th? He says, it's not only your mother I'm honoring. So I'm wondering if there was a connection, you see, with the time. In the Montauk, it's just like it's all adding up with the Montauk project.
Maybe it was a some special secret day or event of theirs.
It was August 12th was when the Montauk project came into being with the Philadelphia experiment.
What year was that?
In 1943.
Maybe he was celebrating the event every year.
Yeah, every year.
The anniversary of the event. Very interesting, fascinating. Do you remember him talking something about Tesla or Einstein?
Oh, yeah. He talked about Einstein. He said what a good man he was. And he says a lot of people think because we're scientists that we don't believe in God. He says, of course he believes in God, but not in the same frame of mind that some people do as an old man with a gray beard. He always talked of it in a form of energy, and he says that's what Einstein thought of. And he always talked about Einstein as such an honorable man, and it was a pleasure to work with him. But I do know he said it was a pleasure to work with him, being part of his team. And that was relevant, that was important.
It's a very interesting comment. So obviously your father worked around the time travel experiments that happened. Tesla was the head of at the Philadelphia in the project at Montauk. He also worked with Einstein. Do you remember him mentioning other German prominent scientists here in the country or any other particularly interesting projects that he was involved with?
Some interesting ones. For instance, he talked about von Neumann as being such a brilliant man. He did talk about him. Oddly enough, since I have this indelible memory, I was very small. I think this was before 1939, so I had to be 3, maybe 4. Now, since I was very well behaved, I was gladly invited by all the elite friends that my parents had, because I was very proper and I was very quiet. And I listened politely. We went to a man that I still think was von Neumann, because he was Dutch, which was a difference in German accents, you see. And I remember details, crazy details, because this man had a humongous jar of like a butter bonbons, we call it, candies.
Yeah.
And he had a habit of eating these butter bonbons, and he gave me some. And I remember my father working with him, and there were some kind of boxes, and I remember red lights flashing. You know, lights, different type of lights flashing. That's the furthest. I don't know what the experience was, but they were lights flashing.
So, it means that your father took you to his lab.
Yes, and he says, never divulge where I take you. We're going to a special place. And my mother used to get mad. She'd be in the kitchen. She says, you're only taking that child along as a decoy. And he looked at my mother and he says, you're absolutely right.
What kind
of a decoy?
Because a father with a child was beyond suspicion, you know, that type.
Do you remember the place that he was taking you to? Was it above ground, underground? How did it look like? And, I mean, was it a huge facility? Was it full of hardware and some other strange things?
It was an apartment in downtown Baltimore. It was very dark. I remember going down a dark hall and a door and kind of opening up like it was, nobody was supposed to know this guy was there. And he was, my father said, this man is a bachelor, and to be very quiet, not to ask any questions, and be very polite and sit. He says, I'm going to do the talking and I want you to be quiet. So when my father said that, that was absolutely so. I mean, I could have sat there 4 hours and not moved. But I did have my bonbons, and I was fascinated by the lights flashing. And that's what I can tell you, truthfully. I remember I might have been 3 and a half or 4, but I saw those, there were like bulbs and lights flashing, and I said, what is this for? He says, a lot of these equipment is for healing, he said.
Fascinating. So you have a feeling or a suspicion that this guy at this private apartment might have been for Neumann that your father was meeting.
Yeah, the reason was because I looked in Al Bielek's book, and I remember, of course, I was very small, and I was always careful to study faces because I was the artist in me. And this man had unusually large lips, you know, and but he had a Dutch accent. And my father says, well, if you understand German, you can certainly understand what he's speaking, and it's Dutch. And I did, because it's like a half English, half German, say. So I do have that memory.
Very interesting. This is another line of pursuit that I've been following in the last year or so. Namely, I've realized for myself that a lot of secret projects, black projects, are financed not even by the government, but by the bankers. And actually, these are the most interesting projects. Shady financiers rent faraway places where crazy scientists pursue ideas that would not be possible to pursue in any academic or even maybe secret government establishment. Because in this way, technologies are arrived at that are 50 to 100 years ahead of even anything that the government has. And this is one of the best ways to keep the secrecy on these things. So, projects about rejuvenation, about healing, even projects, I wouldn't be amazed that the bankers would be involved in projects about immortality. I mean, if I were one of the elite with all the money in the world, literally sitting on a Cheops pyramid of gold, of course I would invest most of my money into projects of immortality. And how are these projects run? In exactly this way. Unobtrusive apartments or farmhouses or whole private plantations. Unlimited financing, and the best brains of minds of the planet are pursuing these goals.
I have some things to add. You were asking me about other scientists. Suddenly, this opened up an avenue, and several ones. One was a Dr. Kerla, K-E-R-L-A. I can't remember his first name, but in Germany, the Germans are very formal. You don't say Fred or Harry.
They use
it's Dr. Kerla or Dr. This. Now, this man, we went over to his house, and interesting enough, he had an ordinary house from the front, but he had not only a basement, he had a sub-basement, which he dug out, which nobody else did in the neighborhood, which I thought was unusual. And he says, come, I'll show you my secret projects. And he did. He showed us all kinds of stuff, everything from creams to powders. And I remember he says, see that in the corner? And I said, what is that? I mean, I've been maybe four or five years old. I'm little, you know.
Uh-huh.
And he says, that's a keg of dynamite. You know, things like that, or gunpowder, and he had all kinds of stuff. And I tell you who backed him. It was Grover Cleveland's grandson. Backed him, had a lot of money.
Who is Grover Cleveland?
He was the president of the United States at one time, but it was his grandson that backed all his projects in Baltimore, and this man became very wealthy from this man who just backed him.
So basically this scientist, Dr. Kerla, was working on... Kerla was working on... He was a chemist and was working on chemical compounds?
All kinds of chemical compounds that he was inventing. One of them was with a large paint company. He invented the paint, I think, that you was the predecessor of what you put on garage floors so that the paint would not wear out, things like that. He did a lot of creams and powders and things like that. And you were talking about certain powders. I remember we didn't drink, but we had occasionally a glass of schnapps or something, and there was gold flakes in this one particular drink called Kölnisches Goldwasser, which was a popular, tastes like Kimmel, you drink it. And I said to Daddy, I said, oh, look at the beautiful sparkles. And he says, well, he said, the gold is a cure. It's a cure-all for a lot of things. If it lodges in your liver or different parts of your body, it cures us all kinds of diseases. But he says, you're looking only at gold. He says, the real answer is in the white powder chemical compound, you know, which is what they call the philosopher's stone. So I knew about that when I was very small.
Fascinating. But we all know that philosopher's stone, this is the secret toward immortality. Some chemical agent that can be produced in any chemical lab with repeatability and predictability that affects our immune system, and probably this trigger mechanism in our immune system that is triggered to respond after 40, 50, 60, 70 years, whatever the average lifetime for the generation is, to start slowly destroying. Basically, it's kind of an autoimmune response where the body, the immune system of the body, the police forces of the body attack their own organism. When the timer of the body says, hi, it's time to leave the scene of this incarnation and make some place for the next waves, next cohorts of generations that are coming. But through an introduction of a simple chemical agent, one can probably stop the aging process and if not totally stop it, then at least largely increase the lifespan. And of course this is a project that all mighty people with money, all bankers and financiers and mighty governments have been involved with secretly ever since time immemorial. I mean, the doctors in the Kremlin hospital, a few blocks down from the Kremlin, have been doing advanced rejuvenation on the ailing heptagenarian and octogenarian Politburo members of theirs. So I wouldn't be amazed that there have been a totally unknown, very little talked about line of research in Germany pursuing the secrets of immortality.
I happen to have two interesting cousins that would interest you in Germany. One is a remarkable businessman who owns the equivalent of Kraft mayonnaise, for instance. An interesting story there. But the woman...
I'm very sorry. Can I ask you to speak a little bit louder just in case to have a better recording?
Okay. And the woman, my other cousin... of course, I'd say 95% of my family's dead because of the war or its repercussion. But this is Dr. Professor. Can I use her name or not? She's living now.
Well, it's up to you.
Well, anyhow, I'll call her Ruth,
yeah.
my cousin Ruth. But she is a doctorate. She is in the East Zone in Germany, but now that the walls are down, I'm sure everything is pretty safe. She was the head nuclear physicist of East Germany, and quite a remarkable woman. She never had any children. And I asked her one time, I said, send me a card of where you work, thinking, or, you know, where you live, where you work, whatever. And she showed me a picture of a castle. So she was the dean of this. And interestingly enough, her husband is or was the head of the KGB in East Germany. But I never...
The head of the Stasi police, the Staatssicherheit, the state security forces, the Stasi.
I was so scared I never did meet her, you know, and I wanted to, but I never did. When I went over there in 85, I thought, oh my God, I don't want people following me the rest of my life and the whole rest of the story. But it was only, you know, family kind of things. If I wrote to her, you know, how is this cousin, how's that one, or whatever little family things that go on in the family. It was nothing, no big deal. I refused to ask her anything, and she never did. It was just, she's just a wonderful person. But a remarkable family, I think, to have these kind of people in it, you know.
So it's fascinating, because the more we talk here, the more I realize that this is quite a serious... your father has been a scientist of major... many important key secret projects. Probably he was involved in Germany in similar projects, and he must have been a very brilliant scientist and engineer. Because the more we speak here, the more we realize that he was a member, a part of basically the most important black projects of the time. By the way, you mentioned that he had 6 doctorates. Do you remember what particular areas were they, or what universities in Germany they were from?
I know he was in the University of Berlin, and I remember a huge diploma. It was one of these huge things, you know. And he says, I want you to see this, and I'll only show this to you once, that's all. He never liked to brag about what he did, and he wanted the neighbors to address him as Mr. Coopers, because he was very understated, especially because he didn't want anything to happen. I know that he had a doctorate of physics, and then it was a doctor of engineering, and it was one doctorate after another. I can't remember all of them. Several. And
yeah.
He had several other diplomas. He's got a whole cupboard full of diplomas that he had. And
do you keep some of these still? It will be very interesting, probably on the next show, to put them in front of the camera. Just
I don't have them with me. My brother has them, and he refuses to give them up.
Huh. Would he make a color Xerox of them, or just a Xerox of them?
I have to talk to him personally. Yeah. He never had a good rapport with my father, because my father and I were close, and my father really never talked to my brother much, and that was it was a bad tear in our family relationship. And so, we have them. I know they're physically obtainable.
Fascinating. So this is right about the time before and during the war. Can you tell us what happened after the war, and whether you had some clues, whether you have some clues about your father working on some projects? I mean, anything, even little happenings around the kitchen table, or little words, drops, or hints, or here and there, that would help you build the bigger picture.
Yeah, I remember even when I was in grade school, he would show me. He showed me a book. I can't think of the man's name now. Maybe he can help me out. That did. He was the first one to work with flying saucers. You know the name.
We're talking about the German person.
I think he's a Russian name, but he wrote the first book on flying saucers.
Could this be Tsiolkovsky? He wrote a lot of books on aeronautics in late last, beginning of this century.
I can't think of the name right away, but anyway, it's a name that's a popular name with flying saucers.
Well, I know several German names, Schriever, Habermal, Mitte, an Italian, Belonzo.
To get on with the story, it's a book that is popular even today, and you know it's pretty popular. But I keep saying Anofsky. I can't think of the man's name, but anyway,
it'll pop out.
Yeah, it'll pop out. Anyway, it's he knew him personally that wrote the book, and he was talking to me about flying saucers, that there was other life, and that he worked on it, and he talked about Project Blue Book and Project Black Book, and then he used to say, I had to represent some scientists, and he says, I had to go to talk to Truman, and he used some phrases that weren't very kind, let's put it that way, because he had no use for some of the things that Truman had done.
Would you please speak again a little bit? Would you please speak again a little bit higher?
He was not pleased with some of the attitude that Truman had with scientists. In other words, you know, you can blow up mankind, but that's just to prove that America is great. But he says, you know, like, he's the president of the United States, and he could give a damn less what the scientists thought. And my father says, you're going to annihilate a lot of people. But Truman, you can't reason with him. He was like a... it was like a person that was uneducated, that was just no reasoning, no politeness, no finesse. It was just a very tough guy to work with.
A bulldozer, the American Khrushchev. Oh, this is exactly, I mean, the perfect guy that the ruling secret evil elite would pick up for a president, a guy that would follow blindly, obey orders without thinking, without even possibly understanding what the subtle things are about.
So the scientists were not pleased with him, and you said, I should think of some of the things that were said at the kitchen table. And I remember I was in my teens, and I happened to have a very momentous lunch with my father. We sat there, and I remember the dogs, the Russian dogs that were sent into space, and those two little dogs, and
the Belka and Strelka, the first two dogs that went into space.
So I've got the time just about right. We heard it on the radio because we didn't have TV. We weren't allowed to have television at home, by the way.
Oh, that's very interesting. Why so? Do you remember any reasons given by your father?
Very simply, he says people who watch television too much, he says you can't learn if you just have a distraction. He says it's just a distraction, good to be used for news or certain things, but not to be distracted. He says it ruins your mind, becomes pudding up there.
Absolutely, absolutely. That's what I've discovered by my own television. The moment I cut out the cable line, and I don't watch television for several months, I'm getting extremely happy and satisfied with my life. So back to the topic about certain such special events.
Right. So we were sitting having lunch, and I heard on the news, like we all sat there in silence and in awe, that these dogs were going up, and it was so fascinating. So we were all celebrating with the Russians, and I said, Daddy, you're so happy with the Russians. He says, we're all good friends. We all love each other. He says, the scientists, he says, He says you don't mix minds with politics. He says the minds are all the same. We all work together. So anyhow, I said, but what's going to become of the dogs? And he said, the last meal they eat, they will be poisoned. And I said, but Daddy, I said, if this is a preliminary of what people are going to do, are they going to kill off the astronauts? It's like, goodbye, Charlie, you know, this is the end. It's nice knowing you. You've done a lot for your country, but the last tuna fish sandwich you have, this is it, you know. And he says, he put his knife, and he's a very serious man, put his knife and fork down, looked at me, and said, yes, something can be done about that. And I said, I started to cry, and I said, Daddy, I don't know what you do, but can you do something about it to bring those dogs back? Because if you do, then I said, the astronauts can come back. I said, I think it's stupid what they're doing. And he says, you're right, stupid. And he got up, forgot what to eat, he went upstairs, and he started to work on some books and papers and stuff. And that was the last, and I never asked him about it again, see? And I found out many years later that he was the one that devised the mathematic, or one of the ones, you know, I never know if it's the one or the one that was working on it, that brought the astronauts back, the mathematical formula for bringing it back. Because I said, Daddy, but they can get them up there. He says, any idiot can bring them up there. He says, it takes someone that's got some brains to bring them back. He didn't mince words much.
Do you remember him talking about some German space exploration using some of the existing rockets? Any hints or clues about such research in Germany before and during the Second World War that was related to taking a person into space?
Yeah, he was talking about working with rockets, and he'd say they test small ones. You know, he would test small ones, and that you could get a rocket into space, you know. And he was talking, let me see, there was something else, it just slipped my mind. There was an experiment that was done on me. All right, this is the German science, that when my mother was 6 months pregnant, I found this out. My mother was angry at my father. They were always had heated arguments, and she said one day, she said, oh, if you're so crazy about your daughter, why don't you tell her that you wanted to have her aborted at one time? And he says, what the heck are you, you know, what the hell are you talking about? You know, I love my daughter. Why would I want her aborted? And she says to me in a very cruel way, she could be very lovely, but she could be very cruel and in anger. She said, your father had a rod inserted in me when I was 6 months pregnant with you to get rid of you. And he put his, it was always the dinner table, put his knife and fork down, and he says, don't you realize, he says, that had nothing to do with it. He says, if she, you know, he says, that was to improve what we already had, to improve the package that we already had. So Dr. Hase, which was my mother's friend and family physician, which was also a German, I don't know if he was a scientist or not, but he was a German gynecologist in Baltimore, well known, inserted this rod in my mother before I was born. And I believe it was an experimental type of thing to enhance psychic abilities.
Did they leave this rod there to stay to the end of the pregnancy, or it was inserted and then removed immediately?
No, it was inserted, and she had to wear it several months.
Very interesting, very interesting. Any other recollections of the 50s and 60s? When did your father die? What year was that?
Supposedly in April, on Lincoln's birthday in 19, 62. My last conversation with him was around Christmas of 61.
Do you remember anything particular about during the 50s and 60s? For example, when the Russians started shooting the Sputniks up and Gagarin flew on 12th of April 1961, so it was before the death of the father. Do you remember him commenting something about space exploration or about possibly that we have already been in space or something to that end?
He's already said, he says, we've already been there. He says, this is nothing but a damn act. And he did say to me in 1956, he was working in Colorado at the Martin Marietta Company to come to see him, so which I did. And in order, so we didn't drive, and neither did he, in order to do this, he said, for me to take a bus, city bus, he set me up in a hotel room, but to the end of the line in Golden, Colorado, okay? And he says, it's only 13 cents. So I said, okay, 13 cents, end of the line, Golden, Colorado, and I was to meet him for lunch. So there he was at the end of the bus, exactly the time. He was always like clockwork. And he says, now we've walked to where I work. And I said, that's the Martin Marietta Company on top of that hill, which was a big flat, like a one-story white building that nothing looking, looks like a factory. I said, why doesn't it say Martin Marietta? He says, it's not supposed to. So we walked up there, walked up the hill, went inside, went to the elevator, and pressed the elevator. There was nobody around, and went down about seven stories. My ears were popping and things like that. I said, where are you taking me, you know? And he says, oh, to my office. I want to show you my office. So I went down there, past security guards, and as I went, he says, I'll take you to my boss's office. Now, I was at least seven stories or a little more, I don't know, down. And on the office walls, I saw 4 to 6 pictures, a series. And they had like a big, it was a artist rendering. It had a nice matte, you know, like it was a hot, well, almost the color of this, like a hot red, beautiful, and beautiful artist renderings. And the artist renderings, this is in 56 now, was the space shuttle of today, the stealth bomber of today, men on the moon, men on space stations, things like that, that kind of thing. And I thought, well, you know, I didn't figure it's anything secret. If they're going to have it exposed on the guy's wall, they'd certainly have it in some kind of classified filing cabinet. But I found out the other day that, of course, if it was that highly secret, it would be down there. It really wouldn't matter, but that was highly secret. So I went, and I didn't know, and he didn't know he wasn't supposed to take me there. So I went through there, and I happened to see his desk. Everything was off the desk, no papers, nothing on it. It was all gray, dark gray, in a gray cabinet, a locked kind of cabinet. Everything was locked. He says, well, everything's locked. We can go to lunch now. And I said, why are you showing me this? He says, well, I want you to see how neat everything is, how neat I am. You're always such a slob. He says, you got your artist papers over everything. I want you to see how neat your father is. And it was like a 20-minute type thing, and boom, and I was out of there, and we went to lunch at the Mile High restaurant. I remember that. Now, the interesting thing was, when I came back, I happened to be an artist at the News American, which is now defunct in Baltimore. I was an artist. And that, like, the next day after I came back from seeing my father in Colorado, there's a guy in a trench coat talking to my boss, wondering what kind of an American am I, and all. My boss says, what the heck did you do, Helga? I said, I didn't do anything. And I was only maybe 20, or I don't know, I can't think chronologically, maybe 20, 21, whatever age that was. And my boss noticed that there were people always watching me, asking questions after that. And that happened for a long time. I'd see people for years, up until I was pregnant with my daughter, I know, till I was 32, 33, somebody always reading a newspaper, whether it was in snow or the heat or whatever, could be 140 degrees outside, somebody's reading a newspaper in a car. And it got to a point, and I used to tell my father that even then, I'd say, what are these guys following me for? And he says, they just don't worry about it. He said, at least if somebody steals your handbag, you're in good hands. Somebody will help you out. You know, he says, feel safe. Don't worry about it. And I didn't. And I still, to this day, I don't worry about things.
So this is a very fascinating thing. What year was that that you saw these drawings? 1961 or earlier? 56. So 1956 drawings. Could this have been kind of a result of a time travel experiment where they went forward in time and saw what would be built 10, 20, 30 years from then? 56 to 1986 when the stealth bomber was built, that's about 30 years. Or could have been that all these projects have been secretly developed 20, 30, 40 years in advance and kept under wraps, and finally when the time comes to pull out the next rabbit out of the hat in order to keep this smoke screen of the Cold War and the competition with the Russian military establishment going, they were just pulling the next machine out of the huge arsenal of available secret weapons and show it to the public as the new and latest invention.
What you just said is what he kind of told me. And I said, what is this stuff on the wall? I said, look at beautiful art. And he said, well, he says, these are projects that are already underway. He says, they always work 20, 30 years in advance. And I said, oh, my God, why so far? He says, well, it's so the public doesn't know. So I'm sure that there's some, like you said, the next rabbit out of the hat will probably be fantastic.
So this means that probably they've been working on a space shuttle type system. Well, basically, when did the space shuttle flew? Like the 70s? It flew like the late 70s or something like that. So they've been working 20 years ahead on such a project.
I know that for sure, because I saw those pictures, and the way my father would talk, it was that our country, he always said, was so great. He says that if any country tried to overstep or hurt us, he says, we have so many underground installations and so much going on underground, he says, all it would take is a button and it would annihilate anyone and anything, he said. He says, this stuff with communism is a joke between the churches. He says, people are so worried and excited, it's a smoke screen. So God forbid somebody doesn't believe in God. He says, who really cares? You know, he says, the point is, the scientists get along. And he says, their technology is there and they work together.
Fascinating. So here I see three interesting issues here. Do you remember how was the shuttle painted? When you say shuttle, obviously it was looking like a shuttle, but was it very same as the shuttle as we know it? Was it?
It was white. But they didn't have it standing up. They had it, they showed it in flight exactly the way it is now.
So it was in flight and no boosters were strapped to it.
No boosters on it.
Were these big hatches of the cargo bay opened or closed?
Closed.
Was it flying in outer space or was it kind of approaching for landing or something like that?
Well, it was, you know, the pictures inside this were about this big, you know, and then there was a big edge around it. But it looked like it was just there to show this. Shuttle. I don't remember it going towards the Earth or anything else. It was like in space.
How do you know that it was in space?
Because the way it was painted in the background with the stars and everything.
Oh,
I see. What other projects do you remember? Do you remember any bases on the moon or elsewhere on these drawings?
Yes. I would see a man in a spacesuit, and I remember the moon, surface of the moon, which is very obvious, and it was as if they were working on it, like people were working on it, or, you know, or it got, like it was not inhabitable, but that people could physically put boxes and gear and things there. It looked like they were putting supplies down or something.
How many people were there on that drawing that you saw?
Two. There's a larger figure in the front, and then there was a smaller one in the back, and they were like putting supplies or something towards the background.
Was there any vehicle visible that transported them there, or?
No, it was just that they were on the surface.
Were dressed in astronaut suits.
Yes, like they were now, the big puffy white ones.
Were there any traces of buildings or any serious dwelling arrangements?
What they had was another picture. The only dwelling that I remember is similar to Star Trek, where they have it looks like a, what do you call that in space, where they have a
permanent station.
A permanent station in space, and it looks very much like the Star Trek type of thing. It was a pointed, and then it was a big thing in the back. And
it's like a wagon's wheel, like a wagon's wheel, a donut-shaped thing with spokes?
Not that kind. It was like a pointed thing, and then it was like a triangular thing in the back, but it was like hanging in space. And you could see the other ships taking off and going back and forth from it.
How many ships were there visible?
Small, maybe two or three on the side. It just showed like they were very pleasantly leaving and approaching.
What kind of ships were these? Do you remember? How were they looking like? Rockets? Like shuttles? Like?
It looked like the space shuttle type thing. It didn't look like oval spaceships.
Was there the Earth visible in the corner of the drawing, or the moon?
Towards the bottom. Like it was hanging, like suspended above the Earth, and then these little ships are going back and forth. And it just a little bit of the Earth, you could see just a little roundness on it.
So basically these were drawings of an orbital space station. And your father said that they are working on these things, I mean, as a project, or they're already, they have developed it?
Developing it. It's already on the way. It's already being done. And he just, like, casually, like, passed me the toast. It was, like, no big deal.
Fascinating. Pass me the toast, please. Pass me the space station in 1956. Unbelievable. I mean, this is a gold mine of information here, a gold mine. Back to the Bolshevik Revolution, and one of my famous topic, hottest topic of research these days, the rumors that the Wall Street and the American banking and business community financed not only the rise of Hitler and the Nazi power in order to do their bidding in Europe, but they were instrumental in financing the Bolshevik Revolution together with the Vatican and South Africa. The Vatican gave several tens of millions of dollars, $50 million. South Africa gave like $600 million in gold. And Wall Street put up the rest of the money, and this is how the Bolsheviks came to power. Russian Tsarist police generals, one of them, I forgot the name, in his memoirs wrote that there were foreign agents handing out money to workers and of course, unemployed seamen in Leningrad right before the beginning of the Bolshevik Revolution. They were basically hiring up their props for the revolution that was about to be filmed on the next day. That it was a major operation financed by the Western financial interests. But even further revelations that all the way back to the Communist International and Marx and Engels and the Communist Manifesto, that all these were financed, planned and orchestrated by the Illuminati, by the leading bankers and financial elite. So back to your father's remark about the Cold War, I mean, what was his attitude during the Cold War toward the Russians? You just said some time ago that, well, I mean, the Cold War is a smokescreen politics, but we scientists are good friends with each other. Do you remember him mentioning any common projects with scientists, with Russian scientists during the Cold War, I mean, behind the smokescreen of the Cold War? Or do you remember him mentioning that, well, maybe this whole Cold War is just a kind of a smokescreen?